Hello and welcome to AK Soufflé. I'm Andrew Kay and I'm delighted to be at the Theatre Royal with one of my favourite people from the theatre and someone I've met a few times before.
You never said that to me before.
The lovely Jodie Prenger.
Hello, how are you?
Really well, it's lovely to see you again.
It's good to be here. I love Brighton.
You love being here, I know.
I adore Brighton.
And the last time you were here and I saw you, you were doing Spamalot.
We had great fun. 4 weeks, we did.
You must have been exhausted.
No, I think the Brighton is one of those places when you do tour, it does uplift your spirits. So we do enjoy coming
here. Well, we love you coming here and saying that because we all love living here.
And I love paying you a fiver to say it, so you're fine.
Where I'll be bribing you later on. But you're actually down here to do Shirley Valentine, and we'll talk about that a little later. But really, I think most people will first remember you from doing the BBC series where they were searching for a Nancy.
I know.
Like we all are, searching for a Nancy. It must have been an extraordinary experience.
It was marvellous. I mean, the BBC looked after us so well, and you go into these things almost like blindsided of what's ahead. And week after week, you never actually think you're going to get through the next round and the next round.
I watched it obsessively, and I have to say, I thought from the word go that you were absolutely right to be Nancy, but I actually thought that you were the rank outsider.
Yeah.
Because all the other girls were skinny minis.
Yeah.
And they looked a lot younger than you, and actually I think a lot of people at that time thought you were older than you actually are.
Do you think?
Oh, absolutely.
Well, thanks a lot for that. I was only 26.
I know you were, but I think the general perception was that you were slightly older than the other girls.
Really?
And you weren't, and I only found that out later.
Did you?
But the minute I saw you, I thought, no, that looks like a Nancy.
I think there was such kind of a wide variety of people in that show anyway. And I'm like you, I didn't think I was going to get it, to be honest. And so I prepared my whole face and stuff like that. And it was just a bonus to win.
Do you have to rehearse doing that smile when
you... I think the main thing is I didn't want to upset my mum and dad. And I just could imagine the look of disappointment if I didn't win. And I think that's why I was trying to keep a brave face.
It's a long process as well. I mean, it's like, you know, you go for an audition and you know within a day or two.
Yeah.
But that was how many weeks?
I think progressively it was 12 weeks was the initial show, but then there was also kind of the pre-show, which was all like you go into these kind of workshops and stuff like that. So there was loads beforehand, and of course all the auditions, and they were auditioning for Oliver's, and so it was a big. I wish they'd do more though. I really, really wish they'd do another show. You know, for Andrew Lloyd Webber to do another one of his musicals. I just think it's brilliant entertainment. It's a great way to get families into the theatre, and it's just, I'm not saying that there's nothing wrong with them, but sometimes most of these reality shows are so flash in the pan, and
soul's being sucked out by most
of them. I just think it's just kids who want to be famous, not, you know, families who genuinely want to be entertained and you know, and go into a theatre, because it's a wonderful world to work in, it really is.
Now, you, like me, are from Lancashire.
Yes.
And Blackpool.
Yes.
Whereas I'm St Helens, which is a bit... I'm a woolly back.
Oh, you're a bit further out, aren't you?
Further out, yes. But you grew up there.
Yes.
Did you always know that you wanted to be on stage?
I think it came from the descendant of my nanny, Terry Doyle, who couldn't sing a note in her head, but she used to mime to Shirley Bassey, and she used to mime, ironically, As Long As He Needs Me and Goldfinger. And it was that, and I remember the Jackie Lester, who was a drag artist that used to come in and sing in my family's hotels. And I just remember looking and going, this is amazing, this is fantastic. And I think it was to grow up in a hub, which was a great entertainment hub at the time, because it was all the big, like the summer shows, which was packed out every night. I think that definitely pushed me towards, oh, this looks fun.
And did you all the conventional things that teenage girls and little girls at school do, go to dance classes?
No, I got chucked out of mine. I was too fat. And I did. Yeah, I'm still bitter about that. And then I went to a girls' school. I'm going to a girls' school and being the chubba wubba that I was, I basically played all the male parts. So I had to go on to do a BTEC course just to play a female role. But it was, I just did it. I mean, I always remember singing and doing supports for people like Ken Dodd and Joe Pasquale. And I still sang the songs from the musicals because I adored them in every which way. And I just wanted to do that.
It must have been great fun going out and supporting people like that. I mean, the big names of comedy.
Oh yeah, Jimmy Cricket, Les Dawson.
Were they
It
kind?
Was great. Oh, they were lovely. They were really, 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 really lovely. So I enjoyed that. And it's, I think it's one of the hardest things you can do is to be a warm-up act. So I think that kind of helped. I think it helped me in the future. It did.
And did you do the Working Men's Club circuit?
I did a few of them. I did the majority I was doing was the gay bars around the UK. I do amazing Liza Minnelli in New York, New York. And then I go into the splits. That's another story. But
you do the splits?
I can do the splits, yeah.
Still?
Not right now, yeah.
I'm just, not going to get you to do it on the table. I don't think we've got insurance cover for that. But
only for one leg. So I used to do kind of lots of... It was just great. But the gay bars were fantastic for me. And I did mainly kind of work for Thompson's and then other bigger venues and theatres for which were warm-up for other kind of comedians.
How did you find out about the BBC series?
Radio. My mum heard it on the radio, and at that point in my life, this is not a sob story, I had given up and I'd gone for audition after audition. And there's a wonderful gentleman by the name of David Grinrod who was auditioning, part of the audition panel for Nancy. And he was the last person I ever auditioned for, because I auditioned for Hairspray in the West End, and I got right the way down and I just didn't get it. So after that, I'd kind of given up, and ironically, it was him who auditioned me. So yeah, so things do come around, things do. My nan always says, if it is meant for you, it will not pass you by. And it was always my dream to do that. And I'm so glad it never passed me by. And I'm always grateful of everything I do, because I do enjoy it. I really do.
Was there a magic moment when you realised you had got this massive voice? Because you have got a great voice.
I don't think I've ever... I think I always got... I remember going to college to do a BTEC course. I went to the National Youth Theatre. But that was mainly straight acting. But then I never really did it thinking, oh, I've got this voice. I did it because I loved it. And I know I've not got the most perfect voice, but I think the one thing I always do, if you always sing from your heart, whether it comes out or goes, it's always true. And I'm not one of those go, oh, my voice is amazing. I just sing from my heart.
And did you play a lot of the gay clubs? Did you play a lot of the gay clubs in Blackpool? Blackpool's got the most amazing gay scene. I love it.
It's brilliant.
Although some of those hotels are slightly... I mean, I stayed in one of the hotels.
Oh, did you?
Frankly, the walls were so thin you could hear boys in the next room unwrapping
condoms.
It was a bit scary.
I've told you not to stay in a toilet. What do you like?
But what I did love was we went to see Funny Girls.
Oh, well, DJ Zoe is one of my best friends.
And it was just wonderful. But I was really surprised at how straight the audience was.
But again, the thing is with Funny Girls, it's a fantastic show, and they do. I've actually not long been. I love it. But again, it's just a brilliant show, and there still is that call for great entertainment out there. You know, you don't have to go into a nightclub where it's like and you can't hear anyone. So it's always busy. So I do know I love me Funny Girls.
And you have a massive gay fan base.
Do I?
Of course you do.
Thank you.
You know that.
Because I'm a gay man inside.
You told me this.
I am.
Which is, I'm seeking for my inner lesbian just talking to you. I've always said that my left hand is actually lesbian. So if you see it straining across the table, you'll know what's going on.
Oh, but it's just, I think, look, I'm so glad they appreciate, and I can sing to people who appreciate the songs I love. You know, and sometimes I remember, funny enough, the one of the first working men's clubs I ever went to was the one in Manchester. And I remember standing there and saying, does anybody like songs from the musicals? And they all went, no. I went, this is Don't Cry For Me, Argentina. But and then when I used to go do Don't Cry For Me, Argentina in the gay bars, the dance version, they went wild. And I love that. So I think sometimes they are the days that I do miss, because I had some fantastic nights. I really did.
And were audiences kind? When I was a teenager, I played in abandoned working men's clubs.
Did
and frankly, you were just playing to the rattle of beer glasses.
It was. I remember, where was that place? They had like chicken wire in front. They did. They couldn't squeeze a tomato through there. And I think it gave me great groundwork. You know, I think it, you know, if you can entertain audiences like that and get them on your side. And I learned an awful lot, surprisingly enough. And I don't know if you, did you do as well? Or did you just want to go down?
I think I learned that it was going to always be something that I enjoy doing for fun.
Yeah.
But I didn't want to make a career out of it.
Oh, did you not?
I enjoyed playing. I played bass. I mean, I wasn't standing at the front of the stage and in the centre of attention. I was the sort of gloomy-looking bass player at the back.
Why did you not want to make a career out of it?
I don't know. I was better at drawing, I think, and that's what I did. So it was a different move for me.
Do you still draw now?
I do, yes. I do. In fact, there's a painting of mine on the theatre wall here.
Is there?
And I will show it to you later.
Thank you.
In a moment, we're going to go to a break. And when we come back, we'll talk about your new show, Shelley Valentine.
Sure, I'll talk to you all.
And Willie Russell. And the fact that this is not a musical. This is a straight acting role.
Yeah.
But for now, we'll just go to the Mads. Hello and welcome back to AK Soufflé and my guest Jodie Crenger, who is here in Brighton this week because you're touring Willie Russell's Shirley Valentine.
Well, I just came for a visit really, but they've told me I have to do a show, so...
Oh, you've got to have any supper this time.
Oh no, it's brilliant.
Are you having fun with this?
Well, it's 30th anniversary, surprisingly.
I was looking that up and I thought, I remember seeing it the first time at the Everyman in Liverpool.
Well, you would have seen it directed by Glenn Walford, who's the same lady who directed this version as well.
Extraordinary.
They've gone really back, and it was herself, Glenn, oh, she's lovely, I call her Superwoman, who commissioned Willie Russell to write this. So it's really gone back to the essence of Shirley Valentine.
Is it something that you've always wanted to do?
It's something I've loved. Yeah. I remember reading it growing up. I remember reading the play first, and then, of course, the film. And it's just that warmth. It's just got such a warm humour about it, and it's so honest. And you don't often get pieces like that where you can be that honest. I mean, we can all put the grease paint on and go out and do jazz hands, but sometimes the hardest thing and the hardest thing to do is to be honest in a production itself. So I had to enjoy it.
I mean, Willie Russell has got the ability to write beautiful dialogue, but this is a monologue, unlike the film, because the film, they filled it out and it had Tom Conti and lots of other people in it.
Yeah.
But this is
you still get Tom Conti?
This is just you.
It's just me.
On the stage.
No one else.
How hard is that? Are you good at learning
lines?
It was
quite, there was 48 pages of script alone. It was all, I think that for me, that panicked me. That was the first scary thing, because it was like learning a book. But the thing is, with the way that Willie Russell writes, It just clicked one day. I don't know what it was, but it was just there. And it's, do you know, half the things that he writes are things that I've said or my family members have said. And so it just felt really quite natural. And then, of course, you have to learn to cook chip and egg on stage every night.
Are you
live?
A real cooker.
Real chips, some real eggs.
So we'll be able to smell the chips.
Of course, you can't.
I'm going to be bloody starving.
Oh, do you know what they do? They have already. I can. The thing is, it's like anything. You do know I can hear you. I remember this one going, I'm so hungry, are you? And you do. I want to offer them a chip. I don't want to, but you can't. But yes, so no, it's all cooked live on stage.
And it's a chip pan. It's not a deep fat fryer.
Oh no, it's a proper chip pan like they used to in the. It's a 70s chip pan. So you come and see a play, you get to see a play in a cookery show in one. I mean, what more can you want?
It's brilliant. Mary Berry, eat your heart out.
Gordon Ramsay, who do you think you are?
Willie Russell wrote an amazing musical.
Oh, he
Love Brothers.
Love Brothers, didn't he?
Why has no one asked you to do that yet?
I know. Funny enough, the lovely Willie.
It tours every year.
I know, it does, doesn't it?
But you're made for it, aren't you?
Hey, listen, never say never. I'd love to do it at one point. I think it's a brilliant, brilliant show, so never say never. I've got Shirley Valentine. Shirley Valentine, I can't ever say it, but I'll say it at the accent. Shirley Valentine, and then Fat Friends, and then who knows, maybe.
And Fat Friends is coming out in the autumn.
Yes, in autumn. We start rehearsals in October, opens in November, and then it tours next year. So, yeah, I'm just getting around. I've got animals to feed. I've got to keep working.
You've still got your dogs?
I've got dogs. I've got chickens. I've got tortoises. I've got fish.
Who's feeding all these
cows? I've got cows.
Cows?
We rescued two cows from slaughter.
Have you become a vegetarian, Jane?
I've actually stopped eating beef.
Have you?
Yeah. I still eat chicken, even though I've got pet chickens. It's awful, that, isn't it?
No.
But I'm very observant of where it comes from and, yeah.
Are you missing singing on stage doing this show?
No, I think it's lovely to do. It was kind of like the premise of One Man, Two Governance. It's great to do something so different, and this business is great for that. It allows you to do that. And I just delivering some of the lines that Shirley Valentine delivers, it's just... I love... There's always a joy in hearing an audience laugh, and I don't think I've ever done anything, probably since One Man, Two Governors, that I've found laughter like that. You know, it's a great thing to have.
Do you get different responses depending on where you are in the country? I mean, does it go down better in the north, northwest?
It's bizarre, isn't it? Sometimes audiences, actually audiences vary night to night, but they always kind of have the belly laughs on certain lines. It's always there. And that's testament to the writing of Willie Russell. You know, it's so kind of... So it's just exceedingly clever how all it's been pieced together. It's great.
I think the interesting thing about the way Willie Russell writes is that he manages to do something which he uses colloquial language, but he also instills a level of poetry
into
the way he writes.
It's got a fascinating rhythm with it. And I always remember thinking that the first time I ever read it, but it has got this, it's got the beat to it. I know it's not musical, but it has kind of got an essence where just the way all the kind of pieces land, like I said before, it does, the only way I could describe it, he makes the ordinary extraordinary. And like you said, just the poetry seems just to flow from that. And just the audiences just lap it up.
There is an amazing sing-song lilt to the Liverpool accent. How difficult to get that right?
I think there was a definite choice going, you can't talk like that. Because if you talk like that, nobody can understand what you're saying. Which was really kind of the broad. So I'm virtually on the edge of the Wirral, so it's a lot softer.
Wirral or maybe Prescott?
Kind of, yeah. I've gone a bit... Because otherwise, I always think, if I can't understand what I'm saying, the audiences aren't going to be able to understand. So there was that definite choice of some of the words to be clear and not as, you know, not as talking like that.
Because it's quite nasal.
It's quite nasal. But Melandra, she talks like that. And you can allow that because they're in short little bits.
You so sounded like my auntie Jean then.
Did I?
It was wonderful, yeah. It took me way back.
Oh, did she cook your chips on that?
Oh, she was the worst cook in the world. She was terrible.
Was she?
Oh, terrible. Shocking.
Why?
I don't know. I think she was a nurse and I don't think she ever cooked. I think she ate in the
hospital. Could you not send it to Marks and Spencer's and get it pre-packed?
Not in those days. Marks and Spencer's, that was far too posh. We didn't get to Marks and Spencer's.
Did you not?
No, absolutely not.
As long as you weren't in ration books, we're all right.
I love the accent, but I didn't grow up with the accent because I just came out of Lancashire.
Okay.
And it was very much Lancashire. So I think my accent is probably closer
to
your accent.
Yeah.
A very far northwest.
Yeah.
The Liverpool one was so different.
We've had people come and go, oh, it's not a real Scouse accent, but I don't think you can do that to let the audience understand. It had to be softer in some points, you know. And it just had to be that. Otherwise, you'd lose half of what Willie writes, I think. And I think that would be a great shame.
Yeah, you don't want to lose the words. I think it's interesting what you said about it being bordering on Wirral. Because we always said, you know, anyone from Birkenhead was a scally with attitude.
Oh, really?
Or aspirations.
the accents fascinate me. I mean, you can literally travel 20 minutes down the road and an accent can change. It's amazing, isn't it? So it was really concise that we did pick a softer accent.
Can you do posh?
Of course I can do posh. I mean, Gillian is terribly posh, isn't it?
Do you enjoy that?
I'm quite schizophrenic. You don't know that. Be afraid. Be very afraid. No, no, it's great. It's great to go. I remember when I went to school, we had all the elocution lessons. And I used to talk quite like that, really, when I first came out of school. But then it just kind of softened and just became...
Do you find it gets stronger when you're at home?
Bizarre. I remember I went to work away for Disney. I was fairy godmothers, very good friends. And I became so broad, I didn't know where I was from. I was walking around going, pie and chips. And it's really weird how your accent does, you know, change and differ. So it's really weird. My dad was Canadian and I could never hear his accent. And my nan and my grandad were from Manchester. But my mum doesn't really have a strong, you know, obviously people hear me, I'm northern, but I go pie and chips.
I've still got a northern accent, slightly.
It's always there, isn't it?
But you're never comfortable. I mean, when I go home and see my family, They all think I'm dead posh.
Oh, do they?
And down here, everyone thinks I'm a northern yokel. You can't be comfortable with anywhere, can you? It's sort of, it's very, very strange.
I just talk to the wall and the rock and they're all right with it, so it's mine.
Now, you're here in Brighton.
Yes.
For the week until Saturday night. Yes. And then you're off.
Then we're off to Malvern, and then we...
Well, they won't understand it at all in Malvern. That's way too posh.
I know, but they'll understand Gillian very much so. And then we're off to, Malvern, and then we do actually get a month off, which will be amazing. But I'm still working in my month off, but, yeah.
What are you doing in your month off?
We're doing a massive Lytham Festival.
Oh, right.
So they're doing a massive musical theatre bonanza, and then, of course, we've got some photo shoots with Fat Friends and stuff like that, so... Yeah, just keep myself busy. I've got to feed the cows and
you've
tend
been
to
busy
chickens.
Since you won that competition.
Yeah, I
and
have
quite
been.
Rightly so.
I'm very lucky though. I'm very great management, but I do love it. I
Are
do.
There any roles that you really hanker after playing next?
Gypsy. Hello, Dolly. Oh, I'd love to go and see Bette Midler do it on Broadway.
I know, but it's so expensive.
It's expensive.
I know. But you'd be good.
Good. Yeah, they're the two I'd love to do. I'd love to do, maybe one day.
Thank you so much for spending time with me yet again in the Theatre Royal. My favourite building as well.
It's gorgeous.
I love it in here. And definitely try and join you for the gin and tonic later.
Of course.
Because it has to be done, doesn't it?
Of course.
Good luck this week. I'm sure it's going to be wonderful. I'm looking forward to seeing it this evening.
Thank you.
And good luck with Fat Friends as well. I have to
Thank
come up
you.
To town and see that.
Oh, I know. I'll come and see you. I won't be cooking chips and egg.
And I can be one of your fat friends. Sadly, that's all we've got time for this week. I wish all my guests were as bubbly and as much fun as the lovely Jodie Prenger.
Stop it.
Thank you again.
Thank you, darling.
Good night.